With me here in the studio this afternoon from i3 Energy, I'm joined by both Majid Shafiq and Graham Heath. Good to see you both. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good to see you, Andrew.
One of the big questions I wanted to tackle first off, I mean, no denying it's been a challenging week for you, particularly in terms of the share price. What's your view here, Graham? It's been tough. There's no denying.
There is no denying that. I would, you know, say as a, obviously we as shareholders, right? Me as a major shareholder, largest private investor, really, in the company, to say that I'm, you know, deeply disappointed is an extreme understatement. We're frustrated by what's been a tremendous volume of stock traded this week, seemingly, you know, mostly on speculation, more than anything else. You know, we can't deny that we're not as happy with the Liberator results specifically as we would have been, more to do with the oil leg itself, in that A2 area. We've had, you know, a couple of difficult wells there, but I don't think we've maybe clearly gotten across the complexity of the Serenity story and the, you know, the hypothesis and the, you know, the analysis, the rock physics that went into that, and the resulting success of that Serenity well. It's a spectacular result for a company of our size, and all of the data points that we got from that aligned with our model. So, you know, what we're seeing today in our share price is based seemingly mostly on market fluctuation than it is on fact. For a company of our size, and certainly now at our market cap, we have access to just a tremendous amount of value, both in Serenity, which we've had a successful discovery at, and very importantly with Liberator, though the oil leg didn't turn out as we wished, the results of the well itself show that there's still been, you know, transmission of oil through that area. I3's, you know, company making upside has always been in the higher relief area out in Liberator West, where there could be 400 million barrels of STOIIP, and up in Serenity, where we carry a conservative value of 200 million. What it's proven is that that eastern lobe of Liberator, where we've been drilling of late, it's difficult sands because they're thinner there, right? So we recognize that, and we're, you know, we are as unhappy as our shareholders with the with what we've seen this week.
So Majid, the drop in the share price, in your view, overdone and unfair?
Yeah, I think it's massively overdone. I think it bears no relation to what we have in the ground. What we had in the ground before we actually started drilling, in fact, remember we had 11 million barrels in the L1 area. So, I mean, it doesn't even bear any relation to that. And of course, we've drilled three wells and we've had what we believe is a huge success on Serenity, which starts proving up what we think is circa 200 million barrels in place with a 40-foot thickness. Serenity, we know, is thicker than that on average, possibly thicker than that on average, because we've got 11 feet in our well, and there's a well off the structure which has well over 100 feet. So it's something between that. We're assuming 40 feet. The volume is directly proportional to that thickness. So just taking those two facts into account, you don't have to do a very complicated calculation on a dollar per barrel valuation, even if you discount it heavily for the fact that these aren't developed resources. You still get a significantly higher number than where we're trading at the moment, which is, I don't know, 12 million pounds or something this morning. So it's massively disconnected, we believe. And then, you know, on Liberator, we've had, certainly the first well was very disappointing, and we spent time, we altered our drilling schedule so we could spend time analyzing that, and we remapped the structure with new data from the well and new seismic data, which told us that we had a thick sand north of the 9 well, which missed the sand. That location on the original mapping had was underwater, you know, and it didn't have the sand, essentially wasn't present there with oil in it. So ostensibly we were taking a big risk in placing that well there, but we believed the analysis that we've done. And the answer we've got is that there is a very thick sand there, of Captain Sand. That's what we found in the 11 well. And we found oil above a water contact, and we found a residual saturation below the contact, which is what we see in the Blake wells and what we saw in the 8 well. So that's actually confirmed that our new mapping is correct, and that we've got migration, as Graham said, of oil from the 8 well into this area, and we've got sandy position in this area. And then we've got the residual zone, which reduces the migration risk into the Minos High. So whilst disappointing, you know, we drill wells to acquire data to refine our models. That's what you do as an oil company. You drill wells and you acquire data and you refine your model and then you act on it. And that's what we've been doing through this drilling program. And we've altered our program accordingly. The disappointing fact is that we thought we had a relatively large phase one development. That's probably going to be smaller. You know, we can't get away from that. But we still do have a potential phase one development, a smaller one, which in itself could still churn out a significant amount of cash flow. But the objective always was, as Graham said, to prove up the significant upside. You know, the real movement in the share price ultimately was always going to be from proving up a few hundred million barrels on our license blocks. And we still have the potential to do that. In fact, what we have found from these three wells is that our model is essentially correct, our geological model. And it's quite a complicated geological model and was most counterintuitive in terms of other interpretations with respect to Serenity. And we've been right on that, on virtually everything that we predicted on Serenity. These fields are all connected. You know, the pressure data we've got shows that they're all connected. You need a regional model to understand it properly. And these three wells have proven up our regional model. In CAP, the technical issues with Liberator and Serenity are different. Serenity is a relatively simple structure with very high relief that dips into a water contact. The Liberator field has got an undulating top with thinner sands. And so the issue that you need to resolve there is predicting where that top is, and it's not easy, and that's been shown by our drilling program. However, what we have, as I said, what we have proven up is that we have sand here, thick capped and sand, and we have oil in it, and we've got, very importantly, this residual zone underneath the contact, which decreases the risk of not having oil to the west. And what we want to happen is oil to have traveled to the west and to fill up the Minos High, which has got this potential 400 million barrels. That potential is still there. What would have been a hugely negative result is not finding sand again in this location, which would have indicated to us that the sand has petered out and we don't have the sand in the west, and that's not the case. So we still have the potential to prove up significant volumes. There are multiple ways to prove up volumes as an oil and gas company. The obvious route is to get production and cash flow, which is great, which is still what we want to do. But the other thing you do is prove up resources which have value in themselves, and the potential to do that is still there. The potential to have a smaller phase one development is still there. And so I think the program, we've had mixed results, but it's been a successful program, and the upside potential is still there in I3 Energy.
What are we referring to when we're talking about a simplified phase one development plan? How much more simple?
Well, initially a single well development in the L1 area to the Blair home, which was when we originally acquired the D block, which is what we acquired from Dana. That had the L1 area in it, which was proven up by the D8 discovery well, and that has 11 million barrels in our CPR. That will work as a phase one development. That was the original plan, was for us to do a very simple development of that area, tied back with a single well to the Blair home. In similar to the Hannay field, for example, which is in the Captain sand to the southeast of us, tied back. In fact, it has a 20-foot oil column, quite thin, developed with one horizontal well, and produced very, very well. As a subsea tieback to nearby infrastructure. So exactly the same as that. Mm. We actually, you know, on our mapping, we've got thicker than 20 foot. We've got 20 foot at the 8 well location, which was drilled on the flank of this culmination. So this thickened, so we'll have more than 20 foot. So that is a very simple development that we originally planned when we acquired the D block. And that's still there as a potential.
Also means that the funding requirement is much lower than obviously a larger scale development, right? So,
well, that's what I was going to ask. How does what you've learned here from the drilling program, how's that going to impact the reserve-based lending facility?
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, with anything, right? The larger the borrowing base, the larger the facility. I think in this instance, the important thing is that though the borrowing base is going to be smaller than what we expected, so will the CapEx be associated with that. So they are, you know, they're not a straight line correlation, but not too far off. So that's fine. I think, you know, to Majid's point earlier, the important thing for us is that we have So what we didn't have coming into 2019, you know, we were out doing a potential farm down. We were also looking at potential lending facilities, and there's always a backstop of using equity, right? You know, what we found is that, you know, the end game showed that we were best to issue equity and raise a loan notes facility in order to conduct a drilling program this year, as opposed to wait on a potential farm down. You know, some of the difficulties in that farm down is, you know, taking a look at Serenity and saying, is there a geological hypothesis correct, right? And we've got a whole other currency this year now because of the success that we've had there as a result, right? So we would expect to utilize that as appropriate. You know, as a major shareholder, and I have a huge degree of sensitivity to issuing equity. So, you know, we will always look to make sure that we're maximizing shareholder value by using the currencies that we have available to us at the time.
Given the discovery at Serenity and the mixed Liberator results, might you not be inclined to focus on developing Serenity firstly?
Well, we will be focused on developing all of our resources. So absolutely we'll be focused on Serenity. And, you know, what we do need to do is to appraise it to prove up the additional volume. So that will be a focus. We believe it's connected to the Tain field. And so, you know, we need to have a discussion with the owners of the Tain field, which we will have, and come to some sort of understanding about that. They are planning to develop Tain. We may or may not be part of that, but, you know, there is a development going on there, which we'll have to have a view on. But we will be absolutely focused on moving Serenity forward as quickly as possible. The OGA will want us to appraise that, you know, so, you know, we are saying that there could be 200 million barrels in place, so the OGA is the custodian of the state's resources. We have to have a plan that satisfies their maximizing economic recovery initiative. So we can't just say, let's put a well in it and put it on production. You know, we have to determine precisely what's there and develop it properly, so we will do that. And Liberator, as I say, we're not walking away from Liberator because it would be foolish to do that. We've still, as I say, our model is intact. It's more complicated than Serenity, undoubtedly, but there is potentially huge resource volume in the West that we want to test, and we should do that. We owe it to our shareholders to do that. You know, we're an oil and gas company. We drill oil and gas wells. That's what we do, and there are risks associated with that. We can't get away from the risks, and we've never said that there's zero risks associated with any of these wells. You can have a production field that's been on production for 20 years and drill an infill well and not find the sand. Now, of course, we'd like to have success on every single well, but we can't guarantee that, and we never will have that. We do still have huge upside potential in the Minos High. Our new maps, which, as I say, this third well that we drilled, confirmed that mapping, it conforms with what we thought in terms of finding the sand in a place where the previous map said that we wouldn't, and we have. That mapping, which we now obviously have become more confident in, is telling us that we've potentially got 400 million barrels. Now, that's potential upside. It's not guaranteed, but it's huge. It's potentially bigger than Serenity. It can be tested with a similarly low-cost, simple well, and so we'd be remiss not to test that, and we want to test it. And we will continue to prove up the resource base by drilling wells. And it's always a question of funding. We'll obviously optimize the funding. But in order to extract value, we have to, as an oil and gas company, we have to drill wells, and that's not without risk.
And what work's going to go into appraising Serenity?
One of the main remaining risks is the thickness of the sand. So when we drilled that well, we didn't think that because we were drilling it fairly high on the structure, we didn't think we'd acquire data that proved up. There's two parameters really that will impact how the volume there. One is the depth to the contact, and the other is the thickness of the sand. And the depth to the contact, we didn't think we'd prove it up at that location, which was selected as a low risk location, so up dip on the structure. But we ended up proving up the 5270 feet TVD subsea contact, which is the contact in all the fields, Blake, Liberator. So that was excellent that we were able to do that. And the biggest remaining uncertainty is how thick that sand is. So what we need to do is to drill one or two appraisal wells towards the west to prove what we think is going to happen, which is that the sand's going to thicken to somewhere between where we have this first well at 11 feet thickness in the east, something approaching maybe 130 feet or so in the west. It's going to be something in between there. That's what we need to prove up, and so that's the focus for the appraisal there. So that's what we need to prove up. Yeah.
And the focus for Liberator next year?
It's similar in that we the upside volumes are always in the west. So in the A4 and the A3, but mainly in this big high that we've got, which is the Minos high. So we need to drill a well basically to test those volumes, and ultimately we do need to drill a well on the Minos high. It will be more forgiving in terms of the uncertainty on the reservoir top. So if we've got something approaching 200 foot of thickness, we think, then obviously if you've got a variation of plus or minus, whatever it is, 20, 30, 40 feet, like Serenity, you've got room, you know, you've got that space in order still to have sand above a contact. And there's a potentially huge volume above the contact there.
So still, Graham, plenty to play for here, if you like.
Almost all to play for. If you look at, you know, our outlook on our in-place resources, it's gone up, not down across the year. Liberator Phase 1 was a small part of that. It's become smaller, but proportionately, it's irrelevant in the bigger picture. You know, we are in the midst of planning a large-scale appraisal program again for next year. Speaking with potential partners, you know, in that regard as well. So it'll be, you know, likely a couple of wells to prove up the majority of the resource up in Serenity. One to two wells in Liberator West, and likely a producer in the Phase 1 area as well, in the, the A1 area.
When we acquired this license from Dana, who thought there was nothing of value here at all, looking back, if we were to project forwards to today, I know we've had huge disappointment, and none of us are happy about what happens to our share price and the way it fluctuates and where it's ended up right now. But if you just look at operationally and the what's actually in the company in terms of our resource base, we would have been delighted to be sitting here saying to you that we have, on Serenity, found a resource that could be 200 million barrels plus that we never acquired a license for. That's appeared there on the mapping because we've done the work, and it fit, and we've done the work on our regional geological model, which predicted that that would be there. That was never in the program, and we're sitting on potentially a resource that could... We know we've got reserves there because we've discovered oil and gas, but we're potentially sitting on a huge resource that was never part of the program. We have that. We've also, you know, the accepted wisdom was that there was no Captain Sand where we have Liberator. You know, there was virtually nothing there. The Blake Channel, Sand Channel, that was it. We've proven that we've got huge sandy position here. In the 8 well and also in these wells, the 2 wells that we've drilled in both the upper and the lower Captain Sand. Still means that our model with respect to what's in the west is still there, that we've got this sandy position there. And what we find in the wells that we drill in Liberator, accepting this risk of the top, is that if you've got sand above a contact, you have oil in it. You know, so if we've got sand above a contact of the volume that we think we've got in the Minos High, there's a high probability that we'll have oil in it. I can't sit here and guarantee that, but there's a high chance that we will have. And the data that we've recovered points to that, in that we've got this, what is a very unusual situation in the North Sea anywhere really, is to have an oil saturation below a contact. And what that's telling you is that you've had oil below that contact. So if you're worried where that contact is and where the sand is above it, you should be worried, because that kind of indicates it's one of the factors that will determine whether sand gets through a saddle, oil gets through a saddle, for example. But whilst it might be unforgiving on the top, it's more forgiving under the contact, in that you've got 30 plus feet where you know oil's been. So you know oil's been underneath that contact. So it's been underneath that contact to the west. So, you know, sitting here from where we were 3 years ago when we just acquired the D8 block, we're in a very, very good position. You know, we've discovered potentially significant resources on Serenity. We've proven our geological model across the basin. We've proven that we've got sandy position where nobody thought we had on Liberator. And we've proven if you find sand above a contact, you've got oil in it. So we're actually in a really, really good position. And I know that as a shareholder, it's not where I want the share price to be, and neither do any of our shareholders. But, you know, I think we have had significant success here with quite a few downs along the way, but that is something that happens if you're drilling in the earth to find commodities, I'm afraid. But we will continue to drill because that's what we—that's what an oil and gas company does, and we think we've got a really good acreage to be drilling on. Mm-hmm.
Just to, you know, just the last point, I think, as well, that there's concern with our, you know, current shareholder base about our funding situation. You know, coming into this year, we had a very thin balance sheet and 16 million pound market cap. You know, we've raised a tremendous amount of money across the year for a company that had that size of market cap. And we've had, you know, what we believe to be a successful program with some, you know, with some hurdles along the way that we faced. It was, you know, never a secret that to continue on hereafter, that would require more funding, right? Either through, you know, a farm down or sale of the assets, you know, working with our senior lenders, which we had been. And like I said, you know, always the fallback of equity. But we've got, you know, multiple currencies now to work with, and we'll plan to work with those. You know, there's been murmurs out there about an emergency fundraise and everything else. That is simply not in the cards right now. You know, we've had a very supportive junior note holder base, the recent support in our equity as well, and that's bolstered our balance sheet to get through the back end of 2020. And we will, you know, need to source additional funding to move forward our program, which we always expected we would do.
Brian, Majid, good to see you both.
Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew.